for this anime, I had really high hopes, for after everyone, myself included, was comparing it to the extremely popular Elfen Lied. After all, both shows share the same writer, Lynn Okotomo. Both have similar themes and ideas, such as girls who have supernatural powers and have escaped from an evil research facility and are trying to survive in the real world.
However, it seems that both adaptations, for the matter of words of Lynn Okotomo, haven't exactly been that great when translated into the anime world. And yes, I do actually really like Elfen Lied, despite all the tits and gore. But the anime also has its share fair problems, very similar to the ones presented in Gokukoku no Brynhildr. So then, ladies, gentlemen, otaku, I humbly present to you, with all my hospitality, my review of Gokukoku no Brynhildr. Let's just hope I'm pronouncing that correctly.
At first, this anime honestly did really impress me with its story. The mystery and build-up presented in the first few episodes were very well done, and made me want to watch more and more, to find out who, or what, these characters are. The anime also followed the manga pretty closely at the beginning as well, and since there are over 100 chapters, I was expecting a well-paced anime series length. But unfortunately, it was all crammed into only 13 episodes, a similar problem that Elfen Lied has. But I'll get to that in a moment. The story revolves around a young man called Murakami, a very bright and intelligent student whose only bad trait is his inability to speak to women. Anyway, at a very young age, he had a friend called Kuroneko who was obsessed with space and believed that aliens really did exist. The skeptical Murakami agrees to follow Kuroneko for proof of these so-called aliens, but unfortunately, she trips and falls with the assumption that the fall killed her on impact. Over the years, he personally holds the drugs against himself, blaming Kuroneko's death upon him. After many years of grieving, Murakami can barely remember much about the girl, and is the only member left of the astronomy club, trying to find aliens on behalf of his passed away friend Kuroneko. While at school one day, a transfer student by the name of Kuroha, or Neko, who conveniently enough looks just like Kuroneko if she had grown up. Of course, Murakami freaks the fuck out, believing she is still alive, before being told that, wait for it, she's not his childhood friend.
What a twist!
This strange girl is implied to have some kind of ability to predict deaths of people before they actually happen. She warns Murakami not to take the bus or he'll die, but being the stubborn dick that he is, he decided to test the theory for himself. But of course, almost dying before Neko comes to the rescue. The curious Murakami follows Neko to where she lives, before discovering that she and her friend are witches and have escaped from a research facility who want them back or killed. Murakami personally takes this upon himself as his responsibility to help the girls and save them by aiding them in getting more death suppressant pills, which are needed or else the girls will die and melt, and also saving and helping other witches along the way, which all have very unique and special powers. During this time, Murakami still tries to review Neko as being his long lost friend.
That is what I like most about the story. Everything always seems so helpless and that everything has been lost, and I really like anime with the theme of survival in them. Brynhildr is a primarily dark drama with some comedy thrown here and there. As a whole, the story is rather generic, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. The strength of the show is the drama presented between characters and how different characters interact with each other and their dreams for the future. But if you read the manga beforehand or even after watching the anime, you'd be sorely disappointed with the anime itself, as the manga is 10 times better, with just overall pacing and everything is just much better.
The pacing for this anime is terrible. As the pacing moves so fast, it skips out a lot of content, important content that we need for character development. In some episodes, they convert 24 manga chapters into one fucking episode. I mean, Jesus Christ! As a result, characters seem bland and rushed, not given nearly enough time to develop. Random characters are added right at the very end of the show, and as a result, the ending was a fucking step to a pure shit. With all this missing content, especially for character development, it's filled with fan service scenes. Whether they're in the bath or just some characters being sexual, it seems that anime can't skip these scenes because, you know, these are so important after all. The manga is much better in both pacing, with the story and overall character development. Now, as for the characters themselves, it seems to be a mixed bag for me personally. The main character, Murakami, fits into a cliche, I'll do anything to help my friend scenario, in which many shonen characters fall under. However, the only difference is that with characters such as Natsu and Luffy, they have a personality behind their characteristics, whereas Murakami just seems like a really bland kind of guy. However, one thing I can commend this character for is the inability to try like a bitch at a drop of a hat. He's also really smart, and the one who's always been up plans to help his friends. I mean, granted, he's no Lelouch, but he's still fucking intelligent. Next, we have the main female lead and useless Neko. She has the ability to break things with her power, which sounds cool, granted, but really, every time she uses it, she almost immediately runs out of magic. She is also the strongest character too in the show, with bundles of untapped energy, but the ending is so rushed, it doesn't really make any sense. Kazumi is a witch, who has the ability to hack into any computer system, and is also the ultimate pervert. She's probably one of the only characters I actually gave a damn about too. Kana was just kind of there. Her power to predict the future was kind of cool.
Neko, nigete!
Doushitano?
Yochiyo, Kana-chan, nani ga miyeta no? Neko ga kurosareru!
But as for the plot as a whole, she really didn't do anything to fuel it. But because of the terrible pacing, some characters I just didn't care if they lived or died in the end. Such as the witch called Hatsune, who makes her appearance in the last few episodes, for her only to die, supposedly one episode later. I kind of like the villains in the show. They had that sick, twisted yandere vibe to them, rather than a villain hellbent on world domination. A lot of vital information was left out of the anime adaptation regarding the main villain of the show. The alien plot points left more questions than it did answers in the end, and everything just felt like a giant clump together sandwich with fucking gravy on top and ice cream! By the end, the show is just so full of plot holes, the characters feel rushed and undeveloped, and this is certainly the weakest aspect of the show.
Another thing that kind of annoyed me is the witches that were sent to capture the witches that have escaped. Aside from them all having really cool traitor powers, they all just fell short. The villains were always presented as these scary, evil, terrifying people that you cannot defeat, and it always hyped it so much. But when it actually got around to fighting these witches, it was a piece of fucking cake. Past all the hype and all the build up and all the tension, the witches are so easily defeated. It's just insulting. There's this awesome witch that can shoot laser beams from her mouth, fucking defeated so easily. Even fucking final boss, the final enemy at the end of the fucking anime, the strongest being could not fucking, Even the big badass fucking triple star S rank witch was fucking defeated so easily. It's just insulting. It was no more than a fucking small threat. As a whole, these trolleys don't really affect the story as much or the anime as a whole, but it was just so annoying to see all this tension rise so fucking huge and then seeing these fucking witches being defeated so goddamn easily. It was just so insulting, and after that, it was about 3 or 4 times, I just lost hope for the enemies. I just didn't care that I knew the villains were going to be defeated so easily. It's like watching Fairy Tale. Oh, Natsu's in a pinch. Never mind, it's fucking Fairy Tale. He's not gonna fucking die. Eris isn't gonna die. Fucking Lucy should be killed, but she's not gonna fucking die. Oh, I'm sorry there. I went off kind of a rant there about Fairy Tale.
It's shit.
So then, did I like anything about this anime? Yes. I liked the ideas and the entire theme of trying to push on and achieve individual witches' dreams for the future. Also, some of my favourite scenes of the anime are just when everyone is doofing around. This made the story seem a little lighter and made you forget for a moment that you were watching a show about female witches being hunted with the possible fate that they may melt in any given moment. As for the music, nothing really gets stuck in my head or is very memorable aside from the first opening, which is now one of my favorites. And strangely enough, I did like the second opening too. It gave me a Death Note vibe from it. The music on its own is pretty good, and something I'd listen to when writing these reviews. It works when it needs to, and sounds good too. The animation is not bad either. It's not the best, nor the worst, but in some places the animation really does shine. It's a lot better than many shows too. But the one thing about the animation that annoys me so much is the fucking censoring. I hate it when anime censor the blood, and here it is, so obvious too, by having big black bars in front of any bloodshed. I mean, I do understand that Elfen Lied went a bit overboard.
Hey, bump bump bump, got any grapes? The man said no, we just sell lemonade, but it's cold and it's fresh and it's all homemade.
But I was initially interested in the show after learning that the writer for Elfen Lied also wrote this. So I wanted to see a little bit more blood anyway. I know it doesn't really alter the show in any way, but I wish they didn't censor it. Overall, this is not the worst thing to come out of Japanese animation. I mean, it's nowhere near School Days bad, and I did actually enjoy the show. But when looking at the show critically, I'm torn towards my own personal enjoyment and a constructive look at the anime from a review standpoint. If this anime had 25 episodes or something like that, their story and anime as a whole would be so much better.
So based on everything I just said in this review, I will be giving this anime a 6.2 out of 10. I highly recommend you read the manga, much over watching the anime. The manga presents the entire story with much more drama, darker themes, character development, and is overall much more enjoyable. And also, it progresses more on from where the anime left off. And the anime left off rather shit. Anyway, thank you for watching my reviews once again. Thank you for helping me reach over 560 subscribers. That is a huge landmark and I am so proud to have that many subscribers. It is growing more and more every day. Every time I log on, I see more comments from you guys. It's just really reassuring to make more videos. And I highly appreciate every single one of you who subscribed, even the ones who speak Spanish. So then, I'll see you next time in my Code DS review. Until then, stay fucking beautiful. I stole that from Brynhidr.